Hello and welcome to Fierce. This program celebrates the diversity of LGBTIQ identities and perspectives. Fierce is produced in Bundjalung country at 2NCR Lismore and can also be heard on podcast at fiercefm.podbean.com and in New Zealand on Fresh FM, as well as all over Australia through the Community Radio Network.
Fierce FM on Spotify and YouTube.
I want to honour the traditional owners of the lands where you are living. They took care of these lands for thousands and thousands of years and then shared this land with us at great cost to their own lives. I want to thank them for the care they have given and continue to give, to sit on the earth, listen and care for country. I also want to thank the fairies and crones who came before us in history to fight for our human right to love fiercely.
He's beautiful. He's a beautiful light. He's a DJ Fradge. Don Balfour is with us. And hi. Don, 1,000 years ago, I was filming him when he was a drag starlet with two other drag queens doing a radio show.
Free FM, and then it was Rhythm FM.
They had Rhythm at the Diaz, and we were at the Aubrey Hotel, we were at DCN's, we were just about everywhere on that strip when it was happening, and who could have imagined that it would all be gone? I mean, I couldn't imagine.
It's not like it was back in the olden days.
That's right. Don is now living in Bris, Vegas.
Downtown, beautiful Logan I live in. Very downtown.
Well, I better call you Tiger something.
DJ Tiger Prawn. It's a bit of a play on the words from the Tiger King because of the hair when it was longer and I had handlebar mustache.
So now you're doing international cruises, but also ones on the Gold Coast and a night called Queergasm. Let's talk about the music. What are you into? I see here on the Queergasm page that you like it dark and dirty.
Harking back to days living in Sydney at the height of gaydom, the most amazing parties. And I know the music was slightly different. Inquisition parties, ice parties. And by the way, ice was a name. I know ice has got a different connotation. It was like a very hard sort of party with hard music, trance and a progressive house and tech house and the beginning of tech house and techno and nothing commercial. It was all about these really organic, dirty beats. After leaving Sydney for a while, I did nothing. And I met a friend who said, oh, you should do DJing. And I just fell into it. I went down the path of being a very commercial sort of DJ and playing your Kylie and your Madonna and Cher and Whitney Houston. And that was the sort of stuff that I played for many years. And then I went into commercial DJs, not as in queer DJs, but electro house and hard sort of music. It was not my soul music. It was commercial sort of stuff, P. Diddy and Lunchbox and all these sorts of guys. The music was just not part of who I was for many years. And then I changed and just played it mainly all the queer clubs around Brisbane. And I love all my queer artists, but I want to play the dirty, dark stuff I used to play when I started. And that's why we're doing Queergasm.
With COVID restrictions and all that, I mean, can people dance at the moment up there in Queensland? And also, can they... Is it a back room or is it just on the dance floor like in the day? When I used to see you at the Aubrey on your knees in the piano bar.
Not me. I was a respectable drag queen at particular point in my life. I was very respectful.
What was your name?
It was Fradge. Everyone called me Fradge. My full drag name was Miss Fragile Frida Free. Everyone just called me Fradge. What's short for fragile? When I started DJing, I had all my old friends on Facebook. It was unanimous. Just use DJ Fradge because everyone will know you. I've done quite a few tours. I did Melbourne, Thick and Juicy with Cam Shafati. I did Melbourne and I did Sydney. And a lot of people remembered me from my drag days and said, oh, I didn't think you were going to be that type of DJ because I was playing very different music. It was very, not girly, but very, very masculine and dark and dirty. And that's the sort of music I love.
Can people dance at Queergasm? And what's the scene like up there now?
Amazingly wonderful. We started dancing officially in December. I am the entertainment director of Club 29, a sex on premises venue and a nightclub downstairs. The nightclub part, we weren't allowed to dance, but the sex on premises part, you were always able to have sex upstairs. we could have sex before we could dance, and now we can dance. What's fantastic. December 2020, the dancing restrictions, there were restrictions. However, we were allowed to dance, and it's been fantastic. So we had a great New Year's Eve up here. Amazingly good New Year's Eve. I felt sorry for everyone right across Australia, but we were partying our little asses off. It was like, yes, it was wonderful. And of course, we all partied that little bit extra harder because we weren't able to party for so long.
Awesome. When I knew you back in the day, Fradge, you were not butch.
Still not.
You're a bit midler. You're a ball of energy. And you still are, but you certainly seem a lot more mask now.
I've always said if I don't open my mouth, I could get away with anything. But as soon as this voice comes out, I'm just so gay. It's just like, no, boy, am I? Wee. Here's something for you. You'll love this. I was Mr. Queensland Leather in 2010.
I remember.
So I really embraced the butchness. And I'm actually really, really, really proud of that. I always have believed in my heart of hearts that I want to leave a wonderful, positive mark on this life. Every single thing that I've done in my whole entire life, like the drag, I never shaved the facial hair off. Walking the Sydney Harbour Bridge in heels, the only drag queen to have walked the Sydney Harbour Bridge with two other drag queens in 6-inch heels, a feather boa, and a dress to keep blowing up. We made world news. No one else is ever allowed to do that. There's all the insurances and everything like that. And we had the full facial hair. And everything I've always done, I want to do it with that little twist. I don't want to do what everyone else has done. So when I went for Mr. Queensland Leather, my whole platform was to call the tribes back, being inclusive of everyone of age, race, creed, or gender, or sexual preference. I think I did accomplish that quite well. And I think that the younger generations even embrace that even more. If a 42-year-old mask, thinnish, tall, very gay man could be Mr. Queensland Leather and still hold those values, I think anyone can do that sort of role or anything in life. And that's how I've always wanted to do it. Yeah.
The competition, the heats.
I call it a movie moment. So I went into the competition. I just come back from International Mr. Leather competition in Chicago. I had just lost my previous partner, Mark, and I just said, I want direction and I don't know really what I wanted to do. So I came back and because I've got very bad self-esteem issues about myself and the way I look. And I think that's the reason why I push myself so much. So I decided to do Queensland Mr. Leather competition. Authentic me to the umpteenth degree. I was very much about who I was and I didn't win. I came second and the gentleman that came first decided he didn't want to do it anymore. He had moved and changed his opinion and his life. He said, I don't want to do this anymore. And that's good for him. Then President Pierre, who is the most very good friend of mine, said, look, Don, he said, you came second. We would really love you to step up to the plate. Now, a normal person would go, no, I'm not going to do this. I'm not. You should have made me. No, I went, right, here is my chance to have this movie moment in my life. So I took this role with such passion and gusto, and I really made it mine, bringing the old guard and the new guard together to forge this new, amazing new leather community here in Brisbane. The lesbians and the trans people and the straights and the gays all together to be this most amazing leather community. I accomplished it a little bit, not as much as what I wanted to, but I certainly did a lot of good for gentlemen and their reclining years of the leather community and bringing them back into our community now and making them feel like they're part of our community. And I was very, very proud of that. When I went down to Melbourne to compete for the Australian title, that was interesting. A whole group of guys in this hotel, a lot of alcohol, not sex. It was very, very PG-13.
Really?
But it really, really was. You're thinking that leather guys would be having sex left, right, and center. No. I'd love to tell you there was wild orgies left, right, and center, but no, it was just about brotherhood and camaraderie, and it was really a lovely experience. However, when I went to Chicago International Mr. Leather, not telling a word.
Tell us.
That was a, let me say this to you. I got kicked out of the lift a couple of times for having some fun in the lift. When we're going up, we would also go down.
The only way up.
Hi, this is Rod, DJ Bigfur, and
Caleb, aka Anita Lobotomy,
and you're listening to the greatest,
most fabulous
radio station in the world,
Fierce FM.
Hello, listeners. My name is Ruben Kay, actress, model, and the only man who goes to the sperm bank to make a withdrawal. And you are listening to the best radio station in the world. The only thing I want dribbling into my orifices, Fierce FM. Enjoy.
Fierce FM on Spotify and YouTube.
You've talked about the leather community here, and of course your first husband, Mark, was very much involved with making that all happen back in the day.
Mark was one of the founding members of Sydney Leather Pride. Mark was a very out and proud leather and rubber guy. We started the Sydney chapter of Rubbermen of Australia. It was actually originally founded in Victoria, of course, with the wonderful Keith Porter. Mark was very much into the fetish lifestyle. Mark and myself actually did bring the puppy play community from America. We brought it over to Australia. I'm very proud to say I'm the custodian of Little Chain with his little puppy name on it. Proud for him because he really spearheaded that sort of thing. Mark was a trendsetter. He really was. He's not the original guy, and I don't want to ever come across and say Mark did all this for the leather community, because, you know, the leather community in Australia was well into the 70s and probably even to the early 60s, but certainly did a lot of wonderful things in the 80s, getting Sydney Leather Pride together, spearheading that, getting Rubber Men of Australia, the Sydney chapter, of course, up and running, and then doing the puppy play, bringing puppy play to Australia. When he got sick back in 2005, when we moved from Sydney up here, a lot of that sort of stopped, and the momentum of his life stopped, and mine too. I changed and changed to be a different person. We were chalk and cheese. He was extremely butch.
He just loved you, and you were full drag, and he was just supporting you. He was quiet support, you know, and he loved you. Yeah, I thought Mark loved me too. I could feel the love. The kiss.
Oh, he hated you. Oh, he hated you. He didn't like you at all. I'm a bitch. No. I've got to tell you this one story, very quick one. A good friend of mine named Portia Turbo. Here we go, drag stories. We went to see a show at Caesar's Bar. All the drag queens were there. We all had drinks, and Portia came out, and we said, oh, and we all went, oh, Portia, best show ever. Oh, I loved it. Everyone was like giving her accolades, and she said, she just had this look in her face like, oh, Jesus Christ. They're all just pandering to me, you know, because Portia is one of the biggest, is the biggest drag queen in Sydney, I consider anyway. So she pushes past me, like, get out of my way, like this. And she just, and she grabs Mark by the arm. She says, Mark, she said, all these pack of fucking bitches won't tell me the truth. What did you think of the show? And I just went, oh, what's he going to say? Because he can't lie. Well, Portia, he said in a very English New Zealand accent, because he was half New Zealand, half English. He goes, I like the show, but I didn't like the last number, and I thought the show went on far too long, and I didn't like this. I'm going action. I said, she's going to punch him. And he was just like, well, because Mark used to produce shows. He used to work for the Lyric Theatre Company. And I just, any minute now, there's this fist going to go poof right in his face. And she goes, Portia, he finishes. Turns around, and Portia turns around to all these drag queens and says, see you back of fucking bitches? That's a friend. That man there is my friend. Come on, Mark, we're going to the bar. Fradge, fuck off. Oh. Claire DeLune did this. I'm using all these names from wonderful friends of mine. Claire did exactly the same thing. Claire, when they used to do the shows at Annie's Bar. Oh, shut up, Miss Free. Now, Mark, you know, because Theta Loon's real name is Mark as well. So she goes, Mark, what did you think of the show? And like this. And he was that sort of person. He never had a mean bone in his body. He always gave people the truth. And that's wonderful.
I knew Portia when I was at Marion Street studying acting. Portia was there before Portia was Portia. But Portia was out and gay and very big. And Portia would probably not remember me because I was a shy little scared little thing. But then I also remember being with you, Drag Surrey Hillbillies, over there. It was some photo shoot, and I was in this room, and Portia was there, and Verus.
Oh, my God.
Remember that day? Yeah. I was so shy. I felt like such an idiot. I was so in awe of you all and just felt like nothing. And now I was filming everything. I just wish I had that footage. Oh, my God.
Well, you know what that is. And, you know, I've got the photos from that. That is from Drag Queens of Media, Sydney Star Observer for the Diva Awards. And I tell you right now, here we go. This is a bit of a coup for you. It was Maxi Shields, who was the media queen that used to write for Sydney Star Observer then, who is now on RuPaul's Drag Race, Claire DeLune, Verushka Darling, Portia Turbo, Beth Devine, Daisy Fantasia, and myself, Vanity as well, because she couldn't make the photo shoot because she was out of town, but we had a photo that Maxi was holding. And I think that was all. I hope I remember everyone, but I think that was it. For some reason, the photo didn't make the cut for the front cover for the Diva Awards for Sydney Star Observer. Hmm. They put Penny Clifford on the front cover and we're going to say, oh my God, you know, and I love Penny. Penny's gorgeous. They wanted to go with a single person, not a group shot of all of us girls together. And it was the most amazing day.
So you talked about the Levis scene being like brotherhoods of media drag queens. What was their vibe like?
Oh, this is actually a very interesting segue. This is about DJing as well. And I mean this with the utmost respect. We are all clamoring for that top spot. And that's what keeps us going to be better all the time. Some of us fall over and we don't get up. And some of us keep going. Drag is very, very bitchy. Look, you got to look at RuPaul's Drag Race. Big hair, big personalities. Anyone in the entertainment industry has got the question, why didn't I get that job? That other person got that job. What don't I have? Why didn't I get that job? Because we all want to be everything to everyone. And that's how we live our lives. You're in the entertainment industry. That's what you do. Striving to be better and bigger. And what can I do to get to that next level? And it's exactly the same with DJs. Who's coming up behind us? There's always someone nipping at your heels. And why didn't I get this job? And why didn't I get that? That's what it's like in the drag industry, the entertainment industry and the acting industry. It's not bitchy, it's competitive.
Thank you, Don. We have to go. We love you. If listeners want to find you, they can go to Facebook for Don Balfour. Where else can they go to find
DJ Fradge, Fradge, or if you want to hear the music that I play, iTunes. But if they want to come along, we've got a boat cruise next Saturday night on the Gold Coast. Gay, lesbian, transgender, bi, queer, white glitter boat party with Wanda De Park, who is the most amazing person. Wanda's just done the SBS documentary. She's a beautiful person.
Wonder Woman. She's Wonder Woman.
She's fabulous. Bloody good friend too. On the 10th of April, if you want to hear the dark and dirty sort of music, Queergasm with my wonderful good friend who you've had on your show, DJ Hector Pascal, DJ Marty as well, who has played at Tropical Fruits, is amazing. And myself, it's really about the dark and dirty sort of music if you really want that queer scene. These events are for everyone. Bring your friend along. Bring your drag queen. Bring your fag hag. Bring your leather man. Bring your trans friends. Bring anyone. We want you to come and have a wonderful time at all these parties. And they are amazing. But Queergasm, no shows, just really dark, dirty, progressive house, tech house sort of music. At Caesars Bar, the Crypt Basement in Fortitude Valley.
What song shall we play to finish the show?
The dark and dirty side would have to be, so many. I would definitely say Faithless, God is a DJ.
Oh, that's a famous number. Tell us about your connection to that song.
Music of the soul. I'm sorry. I could write you a 1,000-word essay on music and why it means so much to me, but it's always been part of my life. Music is spiritual to me. It fills my soul. It just reminds me of being close to spirituality as much as I possibly can be. Because I feel like I'm giving something to everyone when I play that song. When I play music, I'm giving it to everyone. It's beautiful. I just love it. I'm doing something that's pure of heart. I'm taking them on a journey. We're all going together. Come on. It's wonderful on the bus.
Thank you, John. We'll see you soon. We'll see you on the boat.
Yay! Bye! We'll go to the rocks. Don't do that.
This is what I hear in my eyes. It's in natural grace. Or watching young life shape. It's in minor keys. Solutions and remedies. Enemies becoming friends. When bitterness ends. This is my church, yes. This is where I heal my hurts. For tonight, God is... festival. I don't know who got this one, guys, but directly our church, non-exclusive, all-inclusive. That means everybody.
Thank you for listening to Fierce. This program celebrates the diversity of LGBTIQ identities and perspectives. Fierce is produced in Bundjalung Country at 2NCR Lismore and can also be heard on podcast at fiercefm.podbean.com and in New Zealand on Fresh FM, as well as all over Australia through the Community Radio Network.
Fierce FM on Spotify.